Hey, CrossPoint, happy SUMMERFEST. If you've been tracking along with this series, you're going to know that we've had the privilege of hearing messages every week from people inside and outside of our church. And each speaker has been bringing something important to share that God's been teaching them. And I'm delighted that all of our friends have been able to join us. But today we have a familiar face and friend from inside the house, our very own Chris Nichols. He's going to be sharing with us today. And Chris oversees our central ministries, and he has been a pivotal pastor in the life of our church. And he loves Jesus deeply and just demonstrates such kindness and care for others. And I know that that today God's going to use him to speak to you. And I also know that you'll all give Chris a warm welcome as he comes to teach today. So put your hands together and welcome Chris Nichols.
Well, good morning, everybody. It is such a privilege to get to be here and be a part of this series today. I want to welcome everybody watching online, all of our Middle Tennessee campuses. Glad you're with us, and certainly all of you here in downtown Nashville. I've loved this series, all the various voices we've got to hear from. Last week, I was sitting at our Hendersonville campus listening to David Nasser tell maybe the best story I've ever heard in my life. And listening to him going, I can't believe I have to follow this. I have to do this next week. I started thinking, like, maybe I'll just borrow his and tell you, you know, when I was 9 years old, I had to flee Iran. And but I'm so excited to be here with all of you. You know, a series is called SUMMERFEST, and one of the things I love to do in the summer is go to concerts. I bet a lot of you are that way as well. A few years ago, I was going to what was like a bucket list concert for me. I was going to go see Mumford & Sons. Love this band. My idea is that this is just going to be such an energetic show. It's going to be super fun. I buy tickets. I felt pretty good about the tickets that I got. They weren't great seats, but they weren't nosebleeds. I thought they were going to be good until I got to the venue. And that's when I realized that the stage was like all the way over on this side of the arena, and my seats were all the way over here on this side of the arena. In fact, it felt like it was almost as far as you could get from the stage and still be in the building. And I was disappointed because I was like, gosh, I thought these were good seats. I thought, but you know what? The first song started and everyone was standing up and singing. And I'm like, okay, this will be pretty good. And I'm enjoying it. But then we move into the second song and slowly people in my section start sitting down. And by the time we get to the third, everyone is sitting down. Nobody is singing anything. It's like they had taken a vote and I had lost. And there was no energy whatsoever. And I had this idea of what this concert was going to be. But instead, in this section where I'm sitting, it's just dead. Everyone's sitting with their arms crossed, just kind of bouncing their head, listening. And then I look down on the floor. And I see everybody on the floor, and there's no chairs. So everyone's standing, and they're singing, and they're dancing, and their hands are in the air. And I looked at my friend that I went to the concert with, and I said, man, that is the experience that I had expected. Like, I thought that's what this concert was going to be. And he goes, well, do you want to sneak down onto the floor? Now, the answer to that is no, because I'm a bit of a rule follower. I don't like to get in trouble. I don't like to be embarrassed. And in my mind, to walk all the way down, you all know Bridgestone Arena, to get all the way down to the bottom, only to get turned around by a security guard and sent back to your seat was horrifying. Like, no, I don't want that at all. I'm also just very aware as a pastor that I try to hold myself to a high standard, that I try and not do things that I might later regret. And I certainly don't ever want to put myself in a position where I might stand on this stage and tell you to do something that you shouldn't do. But I also don't believe I should stand on this stage and lie to you. So yes, we snuck right down to the floor. It's exactly what we did. It was remarkably easy. You should do it too. And we get down to the floor, and this is what happened. It was amazing. Everyone's hands are up in the air. They're playing. The music is just kind of hitting you in the chest, like the bass of that. Everyone is singing full voice. It is passionate and it is fun. And as it's happening, my heart is just burning within me because this is everything that I would hoped it would be. And then as I'm just enjoying the show, I feel someone come up behind me. And of course, we're packed in there, so it's not like I'm not already around people. But this was different. There was a presence behind me that I felt. And so I kind of look over my shoulder, and it's a security guard. And I'm like, uh-oh. So I'm standing there waiting to get kicked out of the show, nothing happens. And so I kind of give a little more time, and then I kind of sneak a look over my shoulder, and I realize it's not one security guard, it's 10 security guards, at which point, honestly, I was flattered. I was like, I don't know what you guys have heard about me, but I almost never resist arrest, so I'm very agreeable. There's 10 security guards, and as I'm waiting to, like, what is going on, that's when this happens. What I hadn't noticed is that the band had left the stage, had walked all the way back to where I was standing, and there was a small platform behind the soundboard. I hadn't even noticed it, but they go up onto that platform right where I'm standing, and there's only one microphone in the middle of the platform, and they perform a few songs just right there. And I looked up to the section where I was sitting because I'm like, someone should wake them up. This is a really good moment. And I'm so close that I don't actually even need the microphone. Like, I can hear them singing without a microphone at this concert. And it was intimate, and it was vibey, and it was cool. And as it played out, my heart burned within me. And I think that desire to feel something for our hearts to burn within us is part of the human experience. Like, I think it's very universal. It shows up in different places, but I see it in so many places. It's why we go to concerts. It's why we go to sporting events. Think about it. Think how much money and time you could save if you didn't go to Titans games or Nashville SC games, if instead you just waited until the game was over, checked the box score, see who won, go on with your day. You could save tons of time and money, but that's not what we do. Because we actually want to feel it. We want the drama. We want the excitement. We want the tension. We'll even risk a bad experience, a loss. We'll take the risk because when it's good, it's so good because we want to feel something. And it's not just entertainment. It's not just concerts and sporting events. It's true in our work. You know, in the last couple years, there's been this thing that they've called the Great Resignation, where millions of people have left and changed jobs. And when you ask about it, a common explanation you're hearing is people are saying, you know what? I just want to feel something in my work. I want to be passionate about what I do. When I show up for work, I want it to matter. I want my heart to burn within me. And it's not just true in our work, it's true in our relationships. That I sit down sometimes with couples who've been married for a little while and will say, you know what? It feels like maybe we've lost some of the spark that we had when we first got married. I think we've just kind of settled into some routines. We want our hearts to burn within us. Or I talk to people who are still in the dating world, and they say it gets so exhausting just going from bad date to average date to bad date to average date. They said at some point you just want a connection. You just want to be with a person. You want to feel something. You want your heart to burn within you. But where I have this conversation the most is not a surprising place. As a pastor, I have these conversations a lot, and it comes up a lot, and that is when it comes to faith. People talk about this idea, I want my heart to burn within me, and it comes in different places. For some people, they would say, you know what, when I first accepted Christ, I was on fire for God. Like, I changed so much about my life, and I fixed so many things, and I was really faithful coming to church and reading my Bible, but then at some point, it's just kind of faded and faded, and to be honest, I'm at a point where just kind of numb, like I just don't feel anything anymore. Or I talk to people who say, you know what? When I'm here, I feel it. Like on Sunday in this place, my heart burns within me. But to be honest, once I leave this place, real life just kind of floods right back in. And Monday through Saturday, I feel really distant. I can feel really numb when it comes to God. Or I talk to people who are exploring faith. And they'll say things like, listen, I wish I believed like you believe, because I'm looking for hope. I'm looking for answers. I've kind of accepted that things aren't working out my way, and I'm looking for another option. And I would love to choose faith in Jesus. Like, I'd love to have what you have, but to be honest, I'm reading this Bible, I'm sitting in this place, and I just don't feel anything. I just wish my heart burned within me a little bit. And if all of that I just said is true, then you'll understand why there's a verse that when I read it, it just jumps off the page at me. And it's one that I read just as part of a study all the way back to November. And ever since, I can't shake it. I find myself keep coming back to this verse. It's found in the book of Luke, chapter 24, it's verse 30. And it says, when he was at the table with them, and he is talking about Jesus. When Jesus was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. And then their eyes were open and they recognized him and he disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked to us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? And friends, what I would tell you is I am convinced that the Christian life is so much more than church attendance and Bible studies and rules and regulations and an insurance policy to get you into heaven someday. That I'm convinced there is a relationship with our Creator that's available to us that would lead us in such a way that our hearts would burn within us. And I think there are steps that we can take to help us experience that, and that's what I want to talk about today. And to talk about it, I want to explore that story. What I just read you is the end of the story. I want to back up to the beginning of it and just kind of walk through it. And as I walk through, I'll pull some things out of it along the way because I do believe there are some practical steps we can take to develop this in our lives. And so I'll back up. This is Luke chapter 24. It starts in verse 13. Of course, we'll have the verses up on the screen for you as well. But this is what it says. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. So a couple things here. It says, now that same day. So you can ask yourself, well, what day is it? Well, if you back up just a few verses, this is the day of Jesus' resurrection. In fact, in just the verses right below this, what it says is that the women go to the tomb expecting to bring more spices to effectively embalm the body. They get there, the stone is rolled away, the body is missing. So that has just happened, and in Luke's account, this is the next thing that happens. Now, I think that's a significant detail, but I can't really unpack that right now because I'll lose the whole narrative. So the team was very kind. They're going to help me remember this. They're going to put this up on the board behind me, and I'll get back to this point. And it says that on this same day, they're walking 7 miles away from Jerusalem to Emmaus. Now, Emmaus is not that significant of a city. In fact, we're not 100% sure where it is. Scholars have some guesses. If you make a trip to Jerusalem, they'll take you to the place that they believe was Emmaus. But we're not 100% sure, and it's really just because it wasn't that significant of a city. Now, I think that's an important detail as well. I can't get to that yet as well, so we'll put that on the board as well. That way I can keep going with the passage. Excuse me, Chair. All right, in verse 17, he asked them, what are you discussing together as you walk along? That's Jesus asking the question. And they stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? Now, I love this little part of the story because they're walking along. Jesus walks up alongside them. They don't recognize him. They don't realize that it's him. And he says, so what are y'all talking about? And they're beside themselves. They're like, how can you not know what we're talking about? And there's two reasons I love this. The first is they're walking away from Jerusalem on the day of the resurrection. It's been 3 days since the crucifixion. They're leaving at the worst possible moment. Like, you should be staying in Jerusalem. Things are about to get really good. But they're walking away. And I just have to imagine walking away in that moment is probably because at some level, maybe they're confused, or maybe they're disappointed, or maybe they're afraid if they'll kill Jesus, maybe they would kill us too. But for whatever it is, they're walking away from Jerusalem. And I just love the idea of a God who shows up in the midst of that, who will show up with us in the midst of our confusion and walk with us, who will show up in the midst of our disappointment and walk with us, who will show up when we're afraid and walk with us and comfort us. I think it is this beautiful picture of Jesus walking with these two travelers. And I also like that it kind of gives a little historical context. That at this particular time, scholars say the population of Jerusalem was probably 20 to 30,000 people. But during the Passover, which is what's happening now, that would swell and it could be as many as 150,000 people. And what they're saying is everyone in Jerusalem has just watched what happened to this prophet Jesus, and everyone's talking about it. And I think it's significant because if you've ever wondered, how did the story of Jesus get out of the first century? Like, how did it continue generation after generation when they didn't have the benefit of a Bible, when you didn't necessarily have the written word or mass media? Like, how did the word spread? And the reality is the word spread because there were thousands and thousands of eyewitnesses who saw Jesus die and then later saw him alive. So they're saying, how can you not know what we're talking about? Like, everyone is consumed with what's happened to this Jesus. Now, we don't know much about these two travelers. In this passage, one of them is unnamed. They never give the name. The other one is Cleopas. And we don't really know anything about them because they don't show up anywhere else in Scripture, just this one story, this one account. I think that's a significant detail as well. So we're going to put that on the board, and I promise at some point I'm going to get back to these details. For now, I'm going to continue with this story. And so Jesus asked, what things? Like, what are you talking about? About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. See, what I think is significant there is those words, we had hoped. See, it's very telling that in the midst, they were so focused on this very specific thing that they had hoped Jesus would do. In the same way that Moses had delivered the Israelites from Egypt, they had hoped that Jesus was going to deliver them from Rome. They were so focused in on this thing that they had hoped in that they totally missed the larger thing that Jesus was doing, the larger thing he was doing in humanity, even the larger thing that he was ready to do in their lives. They were so focused on this one piece that they missed everything else. And why I like that is because I do the same thing. That it is so easy for us to get so focused on this specific hope we have, this specific prayer request we have, that it's easy for us to miss the larger thing that God might be doing in our story and in our life. But even as I say that, I have to acknowledge a tension. That I understand that, or maybe it's better, I don't fully understand why God doesn't always answer our prayers the way we hope he will. Like, I don't always understand why God moves in some situations and he seemingly doesn't move in others. And it's possible we won't fully understand that until we're on the other side of eternity. But I've lived long enough and I've seen enough to recognize my own tendency to put my hope in something very, very specific. And then later see the wider thing that God was doing, to see the way the pieces fit together in ways I never could have predicted or ways I could have coordinated or controlled. Believe that there is a larger thing that God is doing in humanity and a larger thing that God is doing in us. And so what I would tell you is if you have some very specific hopes right now, keep praying, keep hoping, because I don't believe Jesus is done with you. And he's not done with these two travelers either. The story continues. Verse 22. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. And he said to them, how foolish you are and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. See, I think it's so interesting that Jesus didn't resolve this the fast way. Like, the fast way he could have resolved this is just shown him his hands. He said, here, just look at the scars. Let me resolve this. You're confused. I can solve this for you. It's me. I'm Jesus. I'm alive. I'm the Messiah. I'm the one that was predicted. I know he could have done that because later he does that with Thomas. But in this situation, that's not what he does. Instead, he goes back to the very beginning of the story. He goes back through Moses and the law and the prophets, which effectively for us is the Old Testament. All of this. And he goes back and he starts taking all these individual pieces and begins writing a larger narrative to help them understand that what was being fulfilled through him had been talked about forever, that this is not a new thing. This is a continuation of what God has been doing for a long time. I've got an extended family member who's a retired pastor. And with some extra time in retirement, he had read that passage and said, so Jesus unpacked all of Moses and the law and the prophets. And he just wondered, he goes, well, I wonder what he actually said. So he began studying through the Old Testament, just extracting every time he would find something that spoke of the Messiah or predicted the life of Jesus. And when he was done, it was 42 pages of notes, which speaks to why this long walk, 7 miles from Jerusalem to Emmaus. 7 miles is a short drive, but it's a long walk. But you understand this long conversation that Jesus is having with these two travelers as he's taking this thing that they haven't understand and he's just making it clear. It's so kind. It is so gentle the way Jesus just comes and brings that along to him and he unpacks it. And then the story continues, verse 28. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over. So he went in to stay with them. I love that just because it's a reminder as Jesus is going to keep going. He doesn't just automatically sit down on their table. He waits for the invitation. That is still true of Jesus' character. He does not force his way into our lives. It requires an invitation. He is always willing to come and sit at our table, but we have to ask. So I love that little picture. And now we're back where we started with this story. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. And then their eyes were open and they recognized him and he disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? Now, I think there's a few application points that we can extract from this story that maybe could be prescriptive to help us develop a faith that leads our heart to burn within us, that I don't think it's just something we have to wish for. I think there's practical steps that we can take. The first one that I'd give you is that there is something found walking closely with Jesus that can't be experienced at a distance. I'll say that again. There's something found walking closely with Jesus that cannot be experienced at a distance. See, there are context clues in this story. If you go back and read through it, what you see is that these two travelers knew who Jesus was. They understood his teaching. In fact, there's plenty of evidence to suggest they probably heard him teach. They probably witnessed some miracles. It appears they had some level of relationship with his inner circle, with the disciples. There's even some scholars who have wondered if they were potentially part of the 72 that Jesus sent out to do the work of ministry. So it's not like they were unfamiliar with Jesus. And yet there is something that happens in this moment on the road that is different than what they had experienced before. And it's because when we walk closely with Jesus, we are much more likely to experience our heart burning than we keep ourselves at a safe distance. It was true for them, it's true for us as well. And listen, if you're new to faith, like if you're brand new to this, I'm not pressuring you or rushing you because Jesus says, come and see. So it's a very easy invitation. And so if you're keeping a distance because you're very new to this and you're figuring out, I understand completely. But unfortunately, oftentimes that's where we stay or it's where we retreat to. There is something about Jesus as Savior that is very attractive. That is, yes, it's Jesus loves me, Jesus forgives me, Jesus is gonna secure my eternity. We love that. But the other side of it, Jesus as Lord, sometimes we can hold back a little bit because Jesus as Lord speaks to some level of obedience, the idea that there might actually be something in our life that we need to change, something we need to address, an area we might need to humble ourselves, an area where we might need to ask forgiveness or, for that matter, offer forgiveness. But there can be this tendency to withdraw and try and keep Jesus at arm's length. Kind of protect ourselves, be close enough that we feel like we're in, but not close enough to actually be changed. And the problem with that is the relationship with God that we want, the life that we want, the peace that we want, the flourishing that we want in our lives, it is found when we draw close to Jesus, when we walk closely with him. You know, there's an old story of there's an old farmer driving in an old pickup truck with his wife. And he's driving and she's in the passenger seat and they're driving down the road. And as they're driving, coming towards them is a much newer pickup truck with a young couple driving in that truck. And it's a young guy driving and then his girlfriend sitting with him, except she's not in the passenger seat. She is like in the bench seat right next to him, kind of hip to hip, sitting really close. And these two trucks pass each other. And once they have, the wife looks at the old farmer and she says, why don't we sit like that anymore? And the old farmer thinks for a second, and then he says, you know, I don't know. I'm not the one who moved. Friends, what I'm telling you that is if God feels distant from you right now, he's not the one who moved. If God feels far off and removed from you and your life and your circumstance, I'm telling you, he's not the one who moved. That he desires to be close to us. There are so many scriptures that promise us that he longs to be close to us. That even in the book of James, this verse, if you draw near to God, he'll draw near to you. It doesn't even give any conditions. It's not draw near to God and also clean up all your messes and change everything that's broken about you. And then if it's a good day, maybe he'll draw near to you as well. No, it's a promise. Draw near to God and he'll draw near to you. I find sometimes in my life when I feel distant from God, it's not that he's removed from me. What it really is that I've kind of programmed him out of my life. Like I've so filled every moment of my day with something that I just never actually think about God. So I wake up and it's, you know, I've got podcasts and I'm scrolling on my phone and I've got meetings and I've got phone calls and I listen to music and then I'm doing this. It's just like all day long, I have this need to fill every moment with something. And then I find myself feeling distant from God, feeling a little bit dry. And in those moments, what I have to do when I want to draw close to God is I just have to create some silence and some solitude. Like for me, honestly, turning off the car stereo and not playing music or a podcast or getting on the phone, but just having silence is how I reconnect with God. I can't tell you how frequently, maybe it doesn't happen right away, but just in that space, I begin to start processing things. There are ideas that come to my mind. There are people who are brought to my memory, but it is an intentional way that I've learned to draw near to God when I feel distant. And that's one way, but it's not the only way. I've got friends who draw close to God in nature, that when they want to experience God's presence, they go on a hike and they get outside. And I have friends that draw close to God in worship music and that they have that experience here on Sunday, and they've just learned throughout the week they can just put on some of that same music, some of those same songs, and it ushers in God's presence and they draw close. And the key isn't to do what we do, it's to find what works for you, to be intentional with some of the rhythms and the practices in your life to create space to draw close to God. Because the scripture promises if we draw close to him, he will draw close to us. And if we want a faith that makes our heart burn within us, then we have to remember that that is only found in walking closely with Jesus. It's not found in walking at a safe distance. The other idea that I kind of extract from this story as I was looking at it is that it's not just Jesus' teaching that makes our heart burn within us, but it's also his character. Here's why I say that. These two travelers don't recognize who Jesus is until he's at the table with them and he breaks the bread for them. And what's interesting is he is the guest at this table, so really he shouldn't have been the one serving them. They should have been serving him, but this is how Jesus rolled. This was always the way he was. It's one of the things I love about Jesus. It's a savior who serves in every situation he served, and as his character was revealed to him, that's when they recognized him. And I think sometimes the reason that our hearts don't burn within us is we're going to the scriptures and there is this sense of like, well, it's got to all be here. If I just spend enough time reading it and learning it, if I fully understand it, then my heart will fully burn within me. But you have to remember, they also experienced his kindness. They experienced his love. They experienced his generosity, and it was his character in addition to his teaching. The same is true for us. If you want a faith that makes your heart burn within you, then learn to reflect Jesus' character to others. And there's so many examples and ways you can do it. Like in the time of Jesus, women didn't really have status and they weren't protected, but that's not how Jesus acted. He honored women. He elevated the status of women. He honored them and served them. He protected them. And so if you want a faith that burns within you, guys, especially, I'll just be honest, single guys, you want a faith that burns within you, elevate the value of women in your life. Treat them better than society says you have to. Don't treat them the way society says is acceptable, but instead honor them and serve them and don't objectify them. Don't sexualize them. Treat them the way that Jesus treated them. I don't know if your heart will burn within you, but I guarantee you their hearts will burn within them if you treat them the way that Jesus treated them. And it's not just true with women. How about with kids? Kids didn't have status in this time. They're kind of seen as a distraction or a nuisance. The disciples tried to keep the kids away from Jesus. He said, what are you doing? Bring the kids to me. He even said, like, gosh, if you guys could just have the faith of a child, you would understand me so much better. And so if you want your heart to burn within you, serve the next generation the way that Jesus served them. So maybe that means showing up on a Sunday and investing in kids, or showing up on a Wednesday night and investing in teenagers, or showing up on a Saturday and serving kids in a refugee community, or partnering up with one of our many foster care partners and finding ways to get involved there. But if you want your heart to burn within you, then reflect Jesus' character to the next generation, and that'll happen. And it's not just this. Gosh, there's so many examples. I could spend all day just on this one point, the way that Jesus treated the marginalized, and the way he treated people who had been written off, the way he treated people who were unworthy, the way he treated people who didn't fit, the way he treated people who had been discarded and didn't matter. It's beautiful. It's that alone is just a reason to follow Jesus. It's just when you read about the way that he treated people, to do that as well. Like, I'm just realistic that for most people who have resisted faith or walked away from faith, it's not Jesus' teachings that they have issues with. It's that they've had experiences with Christians who don't reflect his character. And so if we want a faith that makes our hearts burn within us, then we have to be intentional to reflect his character. The world becomes a better place, and we draw closer to God in the process. But I'm realistic that this isn't so easy for everybody. It's easy for me to say, if you just take these two ideas and you begin to incorporate these in your life, I think you will feel closer to God. I think your heart will burn within you. It's easy for me to say in a message on a stage, but what I know is that for some of you, it's not so easy. Like if this wasn't a message and we were just sitting at a table, just like having a cup of coffee, just the two of us, maybe you'd say, Chris, do you know how many layers of doubt and disbelief that Jesus would have to get through to get anywhere close to my heart? Like, are you saying he'd be willing to do that? And I'd say you might be surprised. Or maybe you'd say, Chris, do you know how much pain and wounding that Jesus would have to address to get anywhere close to my heart? In fact, I've built a wall around my heart to make sure that I don't feel anything, to make sure that I can never be hurt again. Are you telling me that Jesus would address those wounds and that pain and that he would break through that wall? You say he'd be willing to do that. And I'd say, you might be surprised. And here's why I'd say that. I think this is the moment where I've got to return back to the things that I put on the board that I haven't gotten to yet. So you see the first one. This story happens immediately after the resurrection, which I think is so interesting because if you're following Luke's account, it means after the resurrection, he does not return to his mother, who sat at the foot of the cross and cried and watched him die. He doesn't go to her. And he doesn't go to his disciples who at this point are hiding behind a locked door because they're terrified and they don't understand what's going on. It's his closest friends and he doesn't go to them yet. That doesn't happen until later. It's the hours after the resurrection. And instead what he's doing is he is walking away from Jerusalem to Emmaus, this city so insignificant that we're not 100% sure where it even exists. And he's doing so with two people who don't appear anywhere else in Scripture. Like, we really don't have any idea who they are outside this story. So let me say this again, say it a little differently. In the hours after the resurrection, Jesus is walking with two nobodies on the road to nowhere, and I don't understand why. I don't. It's kind of the question I haven't ever been able to get past as I was preparing for this message. I love this passage. I love this story. I think there's so much we can extract from it. There's so much good it can do for our hearts and for our lives. I just don't totally understand why it happened. In the hours after the resurrection, Jesus is walking with two nobodies on the road to nowhere. So I started asking. So I asked Google. Google didn't know. Google seems to know everything, but Google didn't know this one. And I asked other pastors, people in my life, of like, hey, isn't it weird that this is the first thing? Like, doesn't this feel like such a detour from the larger story? And other pastors didn't necessarily have a firm theological answer of, well, this is why it happened. I spent time praying about it. And it wasn't until one of those moments of intentional silence and solitude when I was drawing close to God and I was tuning out all the other voices and things in my life that can distract me. And it was in those moments, I'm pondering this question, that I feel like God gave me something. And I'm going to offer it to you, knowing, first of all, this is me talking, this isn't Scripture talking, but I'm going to offer it to you in case it resolves something for you too. In the hours after the resurrection, Jesus is walking with two nobodies on the road to nowhere, and it's because you might be surprised how far out of the way Jesus is willing to go to sit at your table. You might be surprised how far out of the way Jesus is willing to go to sit at your table, to draw close to you, to address your doubts, and to address your wounds and the pain, to be close to you and to make your heart burn within you. Because when the Creator God thinks of you, his heart burns with him. Now, in a few moments, we're going to observe communion together. It is that opportunity to return to the table with Jesus, to reflect on his broken body and his spilled blood both of which were done to secure our salvation out of his great love for us. And if you're at one of our Middle Tennessee campuses today, your campus pastor is going to lead through that. Before that, why don't I pray for us? God, I'm so thankful for the truth of your word. It is helpful, it is useful. It helps reveal your character. It helps remind us who you really are. It reminds us of your great love for us. And I'm realistic that there are probably some in this space and watching that are at a distance from you right now. And maybe it's because they've never chosen you for themselves, or maybe it's because they've taken some steps back. My prayer is that this wouldn't feel like a message that pushes them or instills guilt. Instead, I just feel like there's a strong sense of opportunity, that there is a relationship with our Creator available to us that could make our heart burn within us. And if you're someone who's never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, you could do that so simply today. It's such an easy prayer. Just say, Jesus, I pray that what you did on the cross be applied to my life and my sin. I'm asking you to draw close to me. Something as simple as that secures your eternity and begins this journey with Jesus. But I pray for all of us that we'll draw close to you, that we will find in close proximity to you that your word makes more sense, that what you're doing in humanity makes more sense, that close and in your presence, that our heart burns within us as we experience your peace and your love and your grace and your hopefulness. And I pray from that place of closeness, then we would be equipped to reflect your character to a world that really needs it. Be close to us, Jesus, for we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for your kindness, and we thank you that you walk with us. And it's in your name that I pray this, Jesus. Amen. And we're going to move into a time of communion, worship, and reflection. You know, if you're watching online, I invite you to join us in this. I recognize that you may not have these prepackaged elements, in which case you might have to improvise with something at the house. That's okay. You can grab those things, and we'd love for you to join us. If you're here in the room with me and want to grab these elements, it's funny. We had one of our campus pastors at Bellevue. He's British, and what he says is, if you pull the top tab, it will release the wafer, which I think is such a pleasant way to say that. I always just say, if you pull that tab, you'll get the bread. But I'm going to invite you to go ahead and get the elements open. I'm not going to tell you when to take the bread or when to take the cup. In a moment of worship and reflection, I'd love for you to just to do that just as you're drawing close to Jesus. But let me read the passage that reminds us what this is all about, the invitation that Jesus gives us. It's found in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And so I invite you guys to stand if you're able, or if that's how you choose to worship in this moment. And the team's going to lead us. Receive the elements as you're ready to, and invite you to draw close to God, to engage with him for just a little bit longer.
Our end.
So Jesus, we thank you. Your sacrifice and your love that secured our eternity, that gave us hope, that allowed us to connect and be close to God and makes a way for us. Father, be with us this week. Draw close to us as we seek to draw close to you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. We thank you guys so much for being with us today. I really do hope this week you have time with your Creator that makes your heart burn within you, and I hope you'll come back, and we'll see you next Sunday.